Let's remind ourselves the big picture of where we are. Here is an overview of the class as we're going through it. Yesterday, we spent most of our time on the introduction, reviewing the biblical foundations, looking at the foundational presuppositions, the fact that the Scripture has those qualities that we looked at really is what drives us to preach the Bible, as opposed to get up and just sort of share some sort of inspirational talk out of our own minds, because it is the product of the breath of God. It is relevant in every place, in every time. It is sufficient. There's nothing we need for our souls beyond what God has revealed in His Word. And it is authoritative. And therefore, what else would we do? Why would I stand up and say what I think? That makes no sense at all if you understand those basic foundational presuppositions. Then we looked at the primary arguments for consecutive exposition. As I said when I began, it's not like there is a verse, a slam dunk, go here, this proves we should do consecutive exposition. But I hope by the time I was done with that section, looking at the practical arguments, the theological arguments, especially the pattern of inspiration, this is how God gave us His Word. And then when we looked as well at the biblical arguments, we see the pattern from the Old Testament times, the Levites, the priests, moving into the New Testament time, Jesus and Paul teaching in the synagogue. This is what would have happened. And so we see this pattern unfold, and there is nothing in the rest of the New Testament to lead us to believe that in the weekly worship of the church, anything but that pattern was followed. And so we laid a foundation then for consecutive exposition. We moved from there and began yesterday just barely looking at really the first significant section of our class together, and that is exegesis. You remember the two words we talked about, that everything we do as preachers falls into those two basic words, exegesis and exposition. Exegesis is to lead out of the text its meaning. It's to bring out of the passage we're studying the Holy Spirit intended meaning. To exposit is to make clear. It is to take that exegetical detail that you've pulled out of the text, its meaning, and then to present it in a clear fashion to those that you're teaching. So to exegete is the significant part of our work. If you don't do this, you don't have anything to say. On the other hand, if you fail to exposit, that is, if you fail to make clear, to display the truth of what you've learned to the people you're teaching, then it doesn't benefit them. It may have benefited you, but it doesn't benefit them. And so those two parts of our enterprise, that's how we're breaking it apart and looking at it. And of course, the final one we'll look at, Lord willing, on Saturday a little bit, is delivery. That's what you do with actually taking that expositional message you've created from your exegesis and presenting it, in the process of presenting it. How do you do that in a way that it connects with the people that you're delivering it to? Okay? So that's the big picture of what we're doing in the course. We're just beginning really the heart of our work as preachers, and that is exegesis. Now, really what we're talking about, the big picture here, is a repeatable process for consecutive exposition. We want to have a process both for exegesis, so that when I sit down, and this is how it works, guys. I'm just telling you, you may be one of those people who work several weeks in advance. I do that. I'm always looking ahead, reading ahead, thinking ahead, going through the text in the Greek, several weeks before I'm going to preach it, but I'm not doing the real spade work I'm going to teach you today for the most part until the week that I'm going to preach. So it's kind of a process for me. There's some work that goes on ahead of time, and then the week that I'm going to preach that text, I really sit down and start writing everything out that I've already contemplated and seen in the text, as well as the process we'll go through. And so there is then the necessity to have a repeatable process where you sit down and you're not saying to yourself, okay, I need to study this passage, and you just sort of randomly start somewhere. that's not helpful. That will not produce a standardized result week in and week out. Your preaching will be spotty. There'll be some weeks you come to a good text, easy text, it'll be great. There'll be other weeks when you come to a challenging text or your week is filled with busyness and, you know, emergencies in the church and hospital visits, and the product will be less than stellar, okay? The only way to ensure a consistent result is to have a consistent, repeatable process. And that's why I'm really hammering that with you. I am convinced of that. And you can see that. If you look at the great teachers of our time, I can promise you they have a repeatable process. So that's what we're doing. That's where we are. Now, in looking at exegesis, as I pointed out to you, the lay sort of description of exegesis would be inductive Bible study. You'll hear people, you know, in various fields talking to lay people about inductive Bible study. It's the same thing. Inductive Bible study, exegesis, is essentially the same. Ours being the more technical approach, therefore we refer to it as exegesis. We're looking at exegesis, this part of studying the text itself, in five basic steps. First of all, preparation. Secondly, observation. And I'm going to go back over preparation in a moment. Observation will begin today. Then thirdly, meditation. I noted for you yesterday, I think this is one of the most underappreciated parts of sermon preparation. And I'll show you that the Scripture's very clear about this. Meditation. Number four, interpretation. Once you have you've prepared yourself, you've gotten into the text, you've observed the things and studied the text itself, you've thought about it, you've meditated on it in order to gain greater insight and in order to gain an appreciation for what you're supposed to do with it, then you have to make an interpretive decision. This is what the text is meaning by what it says. Observation, this is what it says. Interpretation, this is what it means. I have to come to a decision. And sometimes that's easy. I mean, there are passages you come to where there's really not much of a decision to be made. Let me give you an example of a hard decision. Go to Romans chapter 2. I think this is the hardest decision I've had to make in Romans so far. It's an interpretive decision. It's not based primarily on just a cursory reading or the apparent data. I think there is data here to support the interpretive decision, but it's a hard one. Look at verse 6. Who will render, this is Romans 2, who will render to each person according to his deeds. And then, beginning in verse 7 and running down through verse 10, there are two groups of people. To those who by perseverance in doing good seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life. God's going to render to this person according to his deeds. Those who persevere in doing good seek for glory, honor, immortality, eternal life. But to those who are selfishly ambitious, here's group two, and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, wrath, and indignation. And then here's group two again. There will be tribulation and distress for every soul of man who does evil, of the Jew first and also of the Greek. Here's group one again. But glory and honor and peace to everyone who does good, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Group two's easy, right? I mean, those are unbelievers. Those are clearly unbelievers of various stripes. The question is, who's group one? There are two primary views, and we'll talk a little more about that later, but you got to make an interpretive decision about who group one is. And read the commentaries, and you'll find there is considerable disagreement. And you have to work through that, and actually, you're going to preach it to your people ordinarily. It's not to say you would never do this. If you think there's legitimate sides both ways, and you're undecided, but ordinarily, you want to come to a decision and say, this is what the text means. And you want to have argumentation to support that. Here's why I'm making this interpretive decision, and why I urge you to consider it. And then the fifth part, then, is evaluation. This is where you are comparing, contrasting what the conclusions you've arrived at with the experts. This is when you're reading the commentaries. This is when you're now, you're reading the commentaries really for a couple of reasons, primarily to evaluate your own interpretation, but also you're looking for additional insights. You're looking for good illustration ideas in some of the commentators and good application ideas in some of the more devotional commentaries. So you're looking for other material, but one of the key things you're doing with commentaries is evaluating your own conclusions against those who have contemplated and studied this passage, probably more than you have, okay? So that's the process. We, yesterday, looked at preparation. Let me just remind you, this is kind of where we still are, but let me just remind you of what we talked about yesterday briefly. You, first of all, have to prepare yourself. And as I said, that's sort of pedantic. I understand that. It's sort of basic, of course. Yeah, let's get on. But guys, I can't emphasize enough that you are not equipped to study the Scripture until obviously you're regenerate, but also until you have a repentant heart. You're truly dealing with your sin. Don't expect to sit down as a pastor, as a student of the Word of God, and grasp the Scripture the way it ought to be grasped in a profound, life-changing way if you're holding on to sin in your life. It's just not going to happen. You know, we can think that way as students, right? You can sort of get in the mode of, well, I can get this, okay? I'm going to read this book, and I'm going to do this. But that's not how the Spirit works. And so don't undersell the importance of that. Prepare yourself in the ways that we talked about. And those are the key ones. Obviously, you got to work hard. We talked about that. There's some other issues there. But we finished last time by talking about your surroundings, preparing your surroundings. And I mentioned you need to have a set time, your best time of day if possible, when you can block out that time. You can be undistracted. You can really use your best hours, your best mental capacity to deal with the text of Scripture. Let me just throw this in. We're going to talk a little bit about scheduling on Saturday, but make sure that you don't give your best hours to stuff. You know, whatever your best hours are, whatever you do, don't schedule meetings that are just meetings you need to have. There's no point in that. You can do that during your hours where you're not as productive, when you're not as fresh. Use your best hours. Schedule your best hours for the study of the Scripture so you're ready to feed not only your own soul but your people as well. So just be really, really careful about that. Have a set place, quiet and free of distractions. Again, you know, if you want to study at Starbucks, you go ahead and go for it. But I'm telling you, I don't believe, even though you think it's true, that you will be as productive in that setting as you will be in a quiet, undistracted place. This is what teachers through the history of the church have done. Get away, get your mind into the text itself and into your study. Surround yourself with the necessary, turn off and shut out all distractions. We talked about that, all the electronics and people, and close the blinds if you have to, and whatever, to keep that eye contact from happening where they've got you. You got to protect that time. And then surround yourself with the necessary resources. We talked, we ended yesterday talking about that, and I will make sure that you get that bibliography that I mentioned that are the books that sort of I surround myself with in both settings, and you can go through that for whatever benefit it may be to you, okay? Any questions that you guys have about all of that we've covered so far before we move on? Anything? Hey, Jesse, good to see you. Lord bless you, brother. Great to see those things happening there. We're excited to maybe follow in your footsteps this fall. Good. All right. So let's move on then. The next part of your preparation is choosing a biblical book. I'm assuming now that you are not in the throes of preaching through a book yet, or the book you want to preach through. We're going to kind of assume that we're starting from scratch. Either you're just coming to a church, or you're looking ahead and you're saying, okay, I want to change my study pattern, my study practices. I want to have a repeatable process. So you need to do this. In preparation, you need to choose a biblical book, preferably months before. I'm always thinking, I know about how long it's going to take me, and you know, you begin to get a feel for when you're going to finish. Hopefully months before I finish what I'm in right now, I'm beginning to think and pray and seek counsel about what to preach next and where to go from there. So, for example, when I was, I'll go through in a moment sort of my own thinking about this in my own place, just to sort of give you a grid for considering, but I'm thinking to the future. Right now, for example, I'm several months from finishing Ruth in the evening. When I preach in the evening, I'm doing Ruth, so I'm already contemplating, okay, so what am I going to do? And I want to make that decision at least a number of weeks, more than a month before I start, preferably several months, so I can begin to really read the book. We're going to talk about that, do some of those basic spade work things. So don't put this off until you're 2 weeks from, you know, ending the book you're doing. You have to always, as a preacher, be thinking ahead. What do I need to do next? Where do I need to go next? And then you want to begin this basic process. So choosing a biblical book, you need to decide what that book will be. Now, how do you choose? I would suggest several criteria for you to consider. First of all, and this is obvious, but consider the needs of your flock. Different churches are in different places at different times. You know, if for example, your church has been hit with, is rife with all kinds of illness and disaster, and you're running from hospital to hospital, then maybe it's time to do something that would be a comfort and encouragement that would bring people to the knowledge of God's sovereignty in their suffering. You know, so you're always thinking like that. Is there something pertaining to my flock as a whole that would be beneficial? I would encourage you, for example, don't start with Timothy or Titus. Those are great books, and they are beneficial, as we learned yesterday, to every believer. But they are specifically directed at the leadership of the church in many places. And therefore, while I don't have any problem teaching through one of the pastoral epistles, I wouldn't choose it as my first book, personally, because you're going to find a lot there that's centered at the teacher, that's centered at the preacher, the elder. Secondly, in addition to considering the needs of your flock, ask the feedback of the elders. If you really believe in a plurality of godly men leading the church, then you believe that they have wisdom to offer as well. You don't need to be making this decision alone. Not to say that ultimately, in my church, for example, the elders have given me the prerogative of making that decision, but I want their input. I want their feedback. What do you guys think? We're here. Often what I'll do is I'll have three or four options that I'm thinking about, and I'll, at an elders meeting, say to them, man, you know, we're going to finish up Ruth in a few months. Here's what I'm thinking. What are your thoughts about these options? And I appreciate and lean on their feedback on that. So don't get that sort of, I grew up Baptist, so I can say this, that sort of Baptist Pope mentality, where, you know, I'm not only the commentator in my church, I'm the only tater, you know, that sort of approach to the mindset of what you're going to do. I'm going to do this. I'm going to make this decision. There's benefit in the plurality of godly men. That's why God has given us a plurality of godly leadership. So ask the feedback of the elders. Thirdly, I would encourage you in a new pastorate to start with a New Testament book. Not because the Old Testament isn't valuable, but as Augustine said, you know, so many centuries ago now, the new is in the old concealed, and the old is in the new revealed. I love going through Ruth, but I wouldn't start with Ruth. I'd start with a New Testament book where the clarity of the gospel and the truth of our faith is set forth. Now, what I want to do next is sort of walk you through my own choices over the last 12 years. Not because these are the choices you ought to make. I just want you to see kind of the thinking process, and you can sort of evaluate your own situation if you're already in a weekly preaching ministry, or as you contemplate, okay, I'm not a pastor, I'm going to graduate soon, I'm going to go be a pastor, what am I going to do? Hopefully, either way, this will be helpful. So let me just kind of walk through my thinking. First of all, let me give you just a little bit of background that I think is important for you to know about my church, because that will factor into the decisions I made. The church had existed more than 25 years when I came as its pastor in 2003, but just before I came, there was a major issue in the church. About a year and a half, 2 years before, the senior pastor got up and publicly humiliated a man in the church without it being church discipline. People immediately knew this wasn't right, this wasn't biblical, there was no grounds for discipline. And so there began to be this groundswell of concern and response. People started leaving. And so the pastor at the time, and I don't want to throw him under the bus, he's a brother in Christ. My prayer is still that there would be reconciliation. But he responded by seating a committee of people in the church to sort of field the charges that had been made against him. And he handpicked those men. Turns out, though, those men were all men of great integrity. A number of them are elders on my elder board today. And they went into this thing thinking, oh, this will be a slam dunk. You know, we'll be here a week and our pastor will be exonerated and we'll move on. But as it turned out, when they began to hear some of the concerns, all about integrity-related issues, they had grave concerns about his qualification for ministry. He had tasked them with doing the research and then presenting their findings to the congregation, which is what they did. Long story short, the pastor ended up being disciplined out of the church. The two other elders were as well, because they sort of went along with the whole thing. There were a number of just breaches of integrity, nothing sexual, but basically trying to keep everybody happy, telling people what they wanted to hear, and of course, in the end, that conflicts. You're telling people different things. You're not being honest. And so he left, went down the street, took about 100 of the people of the church with him. The church began to dwindle and shrunk in size. There was infighting. There were actually families in the church that were split over this issue. In one case, the parents are still at my church. In the other case, the kids went to the split. And so just really a messy, messy situation. They went for about a year and a half without a pastor, and so the church dwindled even more. Just everybody was bleeding when I got there. Okay, so that's the context. So now you come into that situation, what do you do? Well, for me, I first wanted to take just a brief time to make sure they even knew what the church was supposed to be and to do. Not as a criticism of the former pastor, but just as a review of here's what we do, here's why the church exists and how it functions. And so I took 4 weeks, my first four messages as pastor at Countryside, I went through Ephesians 4, the basic flow there of what the church is to be and to do. Honestly, I think that's not a bad thing to do in just about any setting that you go into fresh, is because you can't assume, right, that they even understand how the church is to function. They may have more of a sort of the clergy versus lay mentality where the pastor does everything. You just don't know what you're coming into. So I think laying that foundation is a good thing, and it was very beneficial in the case of our own church. So that's where I started. So then I had to say, okay, what am I going to do after that? Well, the church, as I said, they were bloodied and bruised. In addition, as the former pastor was leaving, having been disciplined, he made the issue about Calvinism. That's what it's really about. It's not about my integrity. There's some people in the church who want the church to be more Calvinistic, and that's the issue. So there's this doctrinal sort of conflict as well, and sort of suspicion. And so I intentionally didn't want to go into that setting with something controversial. I didn't want to go to Ephesians first. Why? Chapter 1, verse 3, verse 4. He chose us in him before the foundation. I didn't know where everybody was. I mean, I was very clear with the pastoral search team, with the church's questions. They knew that I was very Calvinistic in my theology. But I didn't want to pick a fight right out of the gate. The church was hurting. So What is a great New Testament book that is beneficial in a setting like that? A gospel, could have done a gospel. What else? Philippians. That's where I landed. Philippians. Why? Basic Christian living. Nothing controversial. In addition, chapter 4, you deal with the issue of interpersonal conflict. You know, so there was real benefit in my mind to laying that basic foundation. Let's get back to what we're supposed to be doing. This is about Christ. This is about serving, loving Him, following Him. And then when there are, you know, when I got to chapter 4 and I dealt with differences, I made it clear that there are things we ought to have conflict about, but there are other things we should not have conflict about. And so it gave me a great opportunity to deal with that. So Ephesians 4, I mentioned I did in four sermons, Ephesians 4, 7 to 16, how the church is supposed to function. Philippians, I did in 50 sermons. So that was where I began. After, they're still talking Sunday morning now. After that, after Philippians, I went to James. And let me tell you why I went to James. Because, you know, of course, James is the test of a living faith, the looking at the effects of true saving faith versus dead faith, and examining yourself to see if that's true. I thought it was really important because I pastor in Dallas. Can you figure out why that would be important in Dallas? You know, the lordship issue, still a big issue. A lot of churches in my area are rabidly anti-lordship. The Grace Theological Society with Bob Wilkin is in Dallas. And so it's a big issue. And people coming to my church, the church had begun to grow, and people coming from those other churches to my church needed to understand the importance of this issue. And so I didn't, I'm not picking a fight. I'm just teaching the text. We're just dealing with the text as it unfolds. And it's helping set people's thinking straight. So in James, I preached 41 sermons. From James, I went to Ephesians. At this point, there was a level of trust. I knew where the church was, and also I was doing something on Sunday evening. I'll tell you about that in a moment, that sort of helped lay a foundation for this. But I went to Ephesians, and I believe the theme of Ephesians is God's eternal plan. God's eternal plan. There's a key passage buried in the middle of Ephesians in chapter 3, where Paul talks about God's plan of the ages. God's plan of the ages, literally, is what it says. And that's really what Ephesians is about. You have the sort of macro scale of God's plan of the ages in chapter 1, and that is to redeem a people for His Son, but ultimately to cause all things to come under Christ. You remember there in Ephesians 1? In chapter 2, you have the personal application of that plan when God interrupts a life of rebellion against Him and gives that person life, regenerates them in chapter 2. And then, of course, you have the one body, the second half of chapter 2. You have now the two become one new man, the church. And then in chapter 3, He comes to the sort of the crux of that plan, God's wisdom sort of put on the stage of the church in the world. So it's amazing. And of course, chapters 4 through 6, the practical implications of living in light of that eternal plan of God, walking worthy of the calling with which we've been called. So I felt like that was going to be really beneficial for our church because it's rich. Ephesians has rich foundational theology. You've got hamartiology in chapter 2. Wow, do you have that? You've got soteriology also there and throughout the first three chapters. In fact, you know what's interesting about Ephesians? And I knew this was true, but I was shocked how true it was. You know, you talk about the first three chapters being indicative and the second three chapters or the second half of Ephesians being imperative. Let me tell you how true that is. How many imperatives are there in the first half of the book? One. What is it? Remember. That's it. Remember. You come to chapter 4, and it's like imperative after imperative after imperative. You know, I just don't buy the whole conflict in the contemporary sort of cross-centered sanctification model that there's some conflict between indicatives and imperatives. It's just not true. They fit together beautifully in the mind of the Apostle Paul. So anyway, Ephesians, 116 sermons in Ephesians. Mark was where I went on Sunday nights. Well, let me back up because I'm doing book studies right now, so I'll go with Mark. The first book study I did on Sunday night was Mark. And I wanted to do a gospel. I wanted to be in the life of Christ. I wanted to be our congregation to be seeing and hearing the ministry of Christ, the focus on primarily his work, but there is some teaching in Mark, just not as much as the other gospels. And I did 125 sermons on Mark. At the same time, when I finished Ephesians on Sunday morning, I was doing Mark on Sunday night, I thought, you know, Mark has so much of the acts of Christ, but not as much of the teaching. It has, of course, the Olivet Discourse, has some other things, but I thought it would be beneficial for the Sunday morning crowd. My church is like most churches, okay? The larger attendance is on Sunday morning, and then the core people come back on Sunday night. And so I was aware that a lot of people in our church weren't being exposed to the Gospels, to Christ. So I wanted to do something then on Sunday morning that was related to that. And since I was doing the life of Christ in Mark, I thought getting the major sermon, the most famous sermon of Christ in the morning would be really important. In addition, our church was again growing significantly. There were new people coming from all kinds of backgrounds, and the Sermon on the Mount is beautiful for laying out, you know, what a true believer looks like, what kingdom living is really like. And so it was just a great fit on that front as well, for the Sermon on the Mount. 78 sermons in the Sermon on the Mount. And then the next book study I began was Romans a couple years ago. And of course, we'll talk about Romans and its theme even later this morning. It's foundational. It confronts several contemporary trends. I mean, it's foundational because it's at the heart of our faith. In addition to that, it confronts these trends going on, false unity. You know, what is the gospel and what is not the gospel? And those who don't believe the biblical gospel are into a false gospel, according to Galatians 1. It confronts the new perspective issue, which is still out there and growing to some extent. The contemporary grace movement I mentioned, the sort of cross-centered sanctification model, it deals with that. So there were just a lot of reasons that it made sense for me to begin Romans. I am in the middle of chapter 3 in Romans. Next Sunday, Lord willing, I'll finish the first major section of Romans and begin the second major section. In chapter 1, there are 32 verses, and it is so packed and so intense that I preached 27 sermons on chapter 1. I think I showed you yesterday, but you know, I don't write out everything I'm going to say, but I take about 10 pages of notes into the pulpit with me for every sermon. That's Romans 1. So, you know, it's intensive in the theology and the truth that's there. Chapter 2, 29 verses, only 14 sermons, because it's not as intensive. It's not as tightly packed in its argumentation as chapter 1 is. And then in chapter 3, verses 1 to 20, there are 20 verses, obviously, and I preached 9 sermons on those 20 verses. So that doesn't mean you need to do that. I'm just giving you an idea. You know, we all are different. We're different in our approach. We're different in our personalities and sort of giftedness package. You're going to take a different pace. That's fine. But that's just what I chose to do. The big thing I want you to see, though, is the flow of books and thinking and how to think through that as you make decisions. Whatever you do, don't go into a church and say, okay, there's been a big fight over this issue, so I'm going to choose a book that addresses that, and I'm going to wade into it. I just don't think that's wise. Don't hide what you believe. I never, ever said anything but straightforwardly what I believed in the candidating process. So there were no surprises. But at the same time, I don't have to go in the pulpit my first series and pick a fight with half the congregation. So just be aware of that. You do eventually have to deal with those issues. For example, I had to deal with the lordship issue. When I first came to, let me back up and say something important. I told you I didn't go picking a fight. I thought I was choosing something non-controversial in Philippians. Not so. I got to verse 6 of Philippians 1. I had no idea what I was stepping into. I just taught the text. Again, didn't pick a fight, didn't throw out the word lordship 18 times in the message. I just preached the text. And I had 50 people leave the church over it. And there were two men, DTS grads, who led Bible studies. And one of them came and met with me. I had to seek the other one out. And the bottom line is, you know, I was sitting in my office talking to one of them, and I said, okay. I said, so you tell me what I taught from that passage that isn't in that passage. And he said, well, that's not the point. I said, well, that is the point. What's your concern? He said, well, I just hear your lordship under every word you say. I said, well, again, show me. Show me how I misrepresented what that text says. And of course, he couldn't, but we were just on different pages. His favorite book, by the way, if you want to read the worst book I've ever read in my life, his favorite book was a book by Jody Dillow called The Reign of the Servant Kings. Just read chapter 1, and it'll be all you need. It's rabidly anti-lordship. It's staggering, truly staggering. But anyway, I say that to tell you that you can make those decisions and not try to pick fights, and the Lord's going to do what the Lord does, and people are going to do what they do, and the Lord's going to bring good out of it. And so in God's goodness, we lost those 50 people, but at the same time, the church was growing, and it never really felt like we lost those 50 people, and, you know, life continued, and here we are. So let's see. Ruth, then, was the next book I chose on Sunday night. I wanted to do an Old Testament book because, as you could tell, so far I really hadn't. I obviously do refer often to the Old Testament, but I hadn't preached through an Old Testament text. And so I love Ruth for several reasons. One, it is narrative, which I thought I'm doing a lot of the epistles. I thought the variety would be good. Also, it has really profound truths for our difficult, dark times, very much like their times. When believers were living in the middle of extreme paganism and what that looked like and the struggles that created. I keep hitting this chair, so I'm going to move it. In Ruth, I am in chapter 3, verse 5, and so far I've only preached 7 sermons in Ruth. Narrative, you want to take in a little bit larger sections. Plus, it's not as densely packed. There isn't as much to cover. But so, you know, your pace varies with the kind of text you're covering. Now, let me say that although the biblical pattern, as we learned, is weighted in favor of consecutive exposition, there are also biblical examples of sermons that are more topical. It's okay to take the scope of what Scripture says about a subject and explain that as long as it's consistent with the context of which those verses are used. I'll give you the chief example that I just came across recently that just screams at you. Look at Romans 3. You're going to be studying this passage. Romans 3, verse 9 and following. Notice in the translation all those verses that are in all caps. Of course, the translator's way of tipping us to the fact that these are Old Testament quotations. Seven different Old Testament passages Paul pulls from. He's doing systematic theology here, but he's not violating. If you go back and look at any one of these passages in its context, he's not violating any one of them. He is using them in perfect keeping with their original authorial intent, but he pulls them together. I can't prove this to you, but I don't think this was the first time Paul did this. I suspect that this is what he shared when he brought the weight of the need for the gospel to bear when he taught in the synagogues and other places. And he did so not by going to a single text, but rather by pulling respectfully from a number of texts to weave together, and you'll see this as you study it, an amazing tapestry about human depravity. It's profound, not only in the truth of each passage, but in how he puts it together. The flow of thought through these verses. It's truly, truly amazing. So my point is that while I think the evidence leans toward a consecutive pattern of exposition as the normal pattern of our ministry, I don't think that means that it's inappropriate for us to, on occasion, to do more topically oriented studies interspersed with the work on books. And I certainly do that. And if you're a part of Grace Church, for example, you see John does that. You know, you look back in church history, you'll see that's been the pattern. Those who were true expositors teaching through consecutively books of the Bible interspersed series or special messages that were out of that book. And so I think, again, both biblically and historically, we're on good ground to do this. So interspersed throughout these book studies, I also included series on key topics. I won't go through all of them, but let me give you a few examples. When I first came to the church, I told you a little bit about the church's history. The pastor struggled being straightforward interpersonally, but he also struggled being straightforward about key doctrinal issues. It's the same thing, same basic weakness. And so he'd get in the pulpit one Sunday, and he would say, he would really take the lordship position, for example. And boy, all those people in the congregation who were, you know, read the gospel of Jesus and believed in lordship were, yeah, that's great, great message. The next Sunday, he would get in the pulpit, and he would, in what appeared to be just being reasonable balance, that's how he wanted it to come across, would say something that was in line with what a DTS guy would have loved. I mean, one of the anti-lordship DTS guys would have loved. And so, you know, they're sitting there going, amen, that's great. And so the church was in this sort of, they didn't know what they believed about a lot of things because that was kind of a pattern. And so I talked with the elders, and we agreed together that what would be really beneficial was a study in systematic theology for the core crowd on Sunday night. And so that's what I did. Honestly, I thought it was going to be about 6 months. Didn't work out that way. It's more like 3.5 years. But it was really helpful. It was helpful to me because I was forced to deal with the biblical texts related to the major doctrines, and it was really helpful for our congregation just to nail down those issues. I didn't pull any punches. We got to soteriology. We looked at the Ordo Salutis. I walked through, you know, what has to be first, and just explained the Scripture and showed them from the Scripture. And it was so seminal and foundational for that core group of our church because, again, they had been in a situation where they were, you know, uncertain. What does the Scripture say about these things? And so it was just very, very important. I also did because I'm so slow in going through individual books, I don't want people to get lost in the forest for the trees, to miss the forest for the trees. And so there are a couple of ways we've counteracted that. One is our adult Sunday school classes are going through in a 3-year span the Old Testament. And so everybody is exposed to the entirety of Scripture in that period of time. Another thing I did was I did in my own, in the pulpit, I did a 13-week overview of the Bible. In 6 messages, an overview of the Old Testament. In 1 message, an overview of the intertestamental period. And in 6 messages, an overview of the New Testament. Just going through it at blazing speed, giving them a glimpse of the scope of the entirety of Revelation. I also do, and I would encourage you to do, 1-message overviews of a book. Choose a book. In fact, I've got a new goal for myself. I don't want to do too many of these, frankly, because they're really intensive. To do them well requires a whole lot of time. But I want, over the next, I figure I've got probably another 15 to 20 years of pastoral ministry. I want in those 20 years to have covered in an individual message all 66 books. And so, you know, I think that's healthy. It's healthy for the congregation. It's healthy for me. I did some short series on evangelism, marriage, parenting, biblical philosophy of ministry, our church's distinctives. I did this last year because, again, the church continues to grow significantly. We're getting people from, you know, we're getting some new believers. We're also getting people from other backgrounds who, you know, in many cases, I don't really know what those backgrounds are. And so it was important for us to sort of say, here are the things that make us distinct as a church from maybe the other churches you've been a part of. Things like six-day creation, et cetera, the charismatic issue, the role of women in the home and church, et cetera. So those were very important for me to go through. I did a series on worship, a series on the Lord's Prayer, a series on Bible study for every Christian. In addition, and this is something you're going to have to consider as well, I often preach special messages for communion. We have communion once a month. That's sort of the Reformation pattern that sort of began with Calvin because, you know, it felt like less often than that you lose the importance of it in the flow of the life of the church. More often than that, which they'd experienced in the Roman Catholic system, and it becomes something other than it's supposed to be, and it loses its meaning. So kind of the pattern has been once a month. We do that, and not always, but I would say a third of the time through the year, I'll do a special communion message centered on communion. If not, then I'll try to tie my message from the passage to communion in some way that's legitimate and appropriate at the end of the message. Holidays, I'll preach a special message at the first of the year just to sort of set the course for the year. I'll do a Palm Sunday message and an Easter message, bringing us to the focus on the death and resurrection of Christ. In addition to that, I'll sometimes, not always, I'd say less than half the time, I'll do a Mother's Day or Father's Day message. Usually I'll just keep in wherever I am, whatever passage, but sometimes it's just inappropriate, you know what I mean? You come to Mother's Day and you're dealing with sexual lust. It's just not a good fit. So, you know, you want to be wise and say, okay, you know, the better part of valor here is to go somewhere else. And so you make those decisions, but sometimes I will do a special Mother's or Father's Day message. Thanksgiving, I'll usually do a message the Sunday before Thanksgiving related to Thanksgiving in some way. And then I do a Christmas series, a brief Christmas series. I say brief, at least 2 weeks usually. And this past one was 4 weeks because I was dealing with the lies about Christ and sort of how to respond apologetically from the scripture to what you hear around Christmas time about Christ. You know, that he's a myth. He's a mystery. If he did exist, we don't really know what he taught, you know, et cetera. So those are some of the choices I've made. So again, I don't share that with you because you're going to make the same choice. I just share it with you because I want you to see the kinds of ways to think about it as you contemplate what to preach. You have to look at the bigger picture of where is your church, what's going on, what have they been through. Let me warn you one other thing in making these choices. How many of you, let me see again, how many of you are not yet pastoring a church? Let me see your hands. Okay. Let me tell you, this is just the truth. Let this sink into your mind. Own this. Spurgeon said it will take your congregation 7 years to trust you. I agree with that. Absolutely agree with that. It will take your congregation 7 years to trust you. Why? Because think about all the places they've been. Think about all they've experienced. You know, I have people in my church who were in good churches, and then the pastor read something, and suddenly they're going down a different course. And so they're always skittish. You know, when I came, there was this concern of, where are we going? He's Calvinistic. Are we going to become, you know, one of those where we don't share the gospel? They're just always skittish about whatever because they're sheep and because of what they've been through in the past. And so you have to be sensitive to that. You don't want to unsettle them. You don't want to make fast changes, go in and just start changing everything. I'll give you an example from my church. This is kind of a funny one in a sad sort of way. The former pastor, I didn't know this when I accepted the church. I still would have accepted it, but I didn't know this. But he had preached a message that having drums in the church was sinful. I didn't know that. You know, I'm coming from Grace, and, you know, I have a wide, eclectic taste in music. I like a lot of different things, everything from classical to, you know, pop. I can enjoy whatever. And so this doesn't bother me whatsoever. But here are these people who have been told, whose consciences have been trained from the Scripture, that having drums on the platform is sinful. Now, a lot of people who were in the church went, yeah, right, okay. There were plenty of those, but there were some. There were plenty who were convinced that, well, maybe that's right. He's our pastor. He showed us something from the Scripture. And so what do you do with that? You remember they don't trust you, okay? You remember they're not going, he's a wonderful guy, we know him, he loves Christ, he'll never make a bad decision. They're not doing that. They're skittish. And so you don't do anything that's going to unsettle them. They're sheep. They don't like change. So I told my music director, I said, look, you know, at some point in the life of this church, we will have drums. But we're not making that a hill to die on. And so just get used to it and deal with it. You know, we can have great music without percussion. And so for the first 3 years, maybe, I don't remember, 2.5, 3 years, never brought it up, no issue. Then I did a series on worship. And in the process of that series on worship, I did 2 messages on music, the role of music in the church. I addressed it from the Scripture and as the application of Scripture. By the way, I am convinced from the New Testament that the use of instruments is allowed and even encouraged, and we can talk about that later. But so I taught through that passage, through that issue rather, and then I said at the end of that, look, you just need to know that this is what the Scriptures teach. This is what we're going to do. Okay, and from that point forward, we had drums, but I still told my music director, who's a great guy, by the way, I said, Seth, please put the drums behind the plant, okay? Don't make it an in-your-face moment. Don't get the biggest drum set you can get and throw it out in the middle of the stage. There's still people whose consciences are sensitive to this issue. We don't want to unnecessarily anger them. There's no point. I've explained the Scripture. We're going to do what the Scripture says. But let's do this slowly and gradually. And now today, we're in a situation where that's just not an issue. It's just not an issue. We do what we want to do musically. And we're a blended type of worship in each service. Music's identical in the morning 3 services. Both there's some contemporary music. There's some traditional music. We have an orchestra in the morning with praise band instruments added as well for the praise band numbers. I mean, for the contemporary numbers. And then on Sunday night, we have a praise band. And Seth does a great job with both of those. But this is our approach to music. This is what it is. This is what the elders have decided. And now it's just not an issue. But it was an issue. My point in saying all that is when you go into a church and you begin to make decisions about what you're going to preach, what book you're going to go through, and even the other issues, remember, 7 years. 7 years. Now there is an implicit trust with the congregation, those who've been there, toward me and the elders. Why? Because we have a track record. We're doing exactly what we did. We're not changing anything. We're still on the same path. They see that, and there's a level of trust that has come. Okay? So just file that away. All right. Preparation then. To be an expositor, you must first prepare yourself, your surroundings, and you have to select a biblical book that you're going to teach through. Now, once you've completed the preparation, that brings you to the next step, and that is to observation. The observation, of course, is the heart of our study. This is where we take that book we've selected and we begin to understand it. Any questions over anything we've talked about so far this morning? Yes, sir. Yeah, the question is, have I ever chosen a book and either gotten very close or actually gotten into it and realized this isn't the right direction? You know, I've never really had that happen. And here's why. I think you obviously want to be wise. You want to factor in the things we've talked about. But we're back to 2 Timothy 3. It's all useful and beneficial. So some of it may be if you get into it and you feel like, maybe this wasn't the best choice. You can find legitimate ways to bring out the application and the implication of those texts that will fit the situation in your congregation. While there's only one meaning of the text, there are numerous implications and applications. We'll talk about that. And you can suit that better to the situation in your congregation if you've chosen maybe not as well as you would have liked. Just stay the course, yeah. Again, the Word of God is the Word of God. And I know you've all experienced this. You know, I preach a message, and the theme of the message is the theme of the passage, but somewhere along the line, I mention something in passing. And, you know, five people come up to me afterwards, and that's the thing that stood out to them. That's the thing the Spirit really rung their bell about and that convicted them or encouraged them or whatever. And so that's the beauty of Scripture, is I can preach whatever passage, Leviticus, you know, the genealogies, and I can know that somehow the Spirit is going to use that in ways I didn't even intend in the lives of the people who hear it. And that's the beauty of a living book like the Scripture is. So I would say once you want to be as wise as possible to make those decisions, seek counsel, you know, pray about that, take time on it. But in the end, when you make that decision, it's the Scripture. None of it's going to be bad. So just wade in and do what you do and trust the Lord to make the outcome. You said you had another?
Yeah. And to what extent, when you introduce a series, do you reveal your reasons publicly to the congregation? I'm sure there are some cases that would be helpful and some instances maybe where you don't
want to. Yeah, you know, that's a great question. And ordinarily, if it's a controversial reason, I wouldn't reveal it to the congregation. I just let the Bible do what it does. You know, Spurgeon said, the Bible is like a lion. It doesn't need to be defended. You just open the cage and let it out, and it'll take care of itself. And that's what we do as preachers, you know. Just let it do its work. Let the Word and the Spirit do their work. And so if it's a concern I have with the congregation or whatever, then I wouldn't share it. Plus, that's only part of the reason, always, because like with Romans, those aren't the reasons I shared with you aren't the only reasons I chose Romans. I want to study the book. It's the most magnificent letter Paul wrote. And so it's complicated. There are a lot of reasons. And so I would rarely share my reasons for choosing it. It's there. It's in Scripture. It's inspired. Let's go. Let's look at it. But if I feel like it's going to be helpful to give context, like with Ruth, I thought it was important to say, why did I choose Ruth out of all the Old Testament books I could have chosen? Well, because it's so well suited to the pagan culture we live in, where there are true believers living in this sea of paganism, both within Israel in their case, and of course in Moab with Ruth and the family of Elimelech.
Hopefully, what would your recommendation be in terms of choosing a book? Of course, they're going to have an elder board prior to launching, which would hopefully inform them as to which book, but any recommendations for those who...
Yeah, you know, I don't think the recommendations for planning a church are much different than the ones we've talked about. I mean, I still think if I were planning a church, I would want to lay a foundation for what the church is. So I think something... You know, Ephesians 4, something that's going to bring to bear, here's how it's to function. You know, we're beginning this. This is what it looks like. And then from there, I think any of the resources we've talked about, you know, basic Philippians, always a great book because it's filled with those attitudes and mindsets of, you know, of Christ and the gospel being central, of, you know, of dealing with our pride and learning how to get along with each other, chapter 2, you know, et cetera. So there, I think if I were going into a church plant situation, and I don't think I'm really wired for church planting, but if I were going to do that, I wouldn't take much different a route than that. I think exposing people to the Gospels, always a great thing. Again, because you're getting, even at a church plant, you're getting people that you don't know, and you don't know their church backgrounds, something that brings the gospel to bear, you know? All those normal things, when you're meeting people, interacting with people you don't know, you really don't know, I think that's a good thing. You know, John's first message here at Grace Church was what? You remember? Anybody remember? I know you weren't here, but have you heard this? Yeah, how to play church. Dealing with, essentially, the examine yourself to the reality of your faith. That's been a theme of his ministry. It began the first message. So, you know, I think you have to, again, back to what we talked about, you have to look at that group of people. Where are they? What are the church situations they're coming out of? You know, what are they experiencing right now? And begin to look at that from that perspective.
Things would impact the church from the outside, like the Supreme Court decision on homosexuality.
Yeah, good question. Do you ever vary your preaching schedule to deal with big issues going on in the culture? I have done that. I don't do that very often, but when it's something that I know everybody in my congregation is up in arms about, they're in Texas, literally up in arms about, but you know, they're in some degree of angst about, then I want to address that from a biblical perspective. You know, I want to take them through, okay, how do we think about this biblically? So when the Supreme Court decision came down, I did a message on sort of our response to that, our understanding of that in the larger scope of our culture. So you want to give that biblical insight. And again, I think there's biblical warrant to that. You have a couple of books in the Scripture that were written in response to human tragedy, Lamentations obviously being the chief example, to sort of grasp and comprehend from a biblical perspective what's happening. So I think there is a place for that. I just wouldn't overdo it. I mean, I would never do that more than, once a year, you know, but not even that. I don't think, if you look back over the 12 years of my ministry at Countryside, I think there probably have been maybe 5 or 6 times I've done that. But I'm not afraid to do that. I don't want to respond to every little, you know, the latest viral video that went, you know,